Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Heritage Foods Q1 FY22 earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this call is being recorded. I would now like to hand the floor over to Mr. Hiral Keniya. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Tanvi. Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to the earnings call of Heritage Foods Limited for Q1 FY22. Today, we have with us the management represented by Mrs. N. Brahmani, Executive Director, Dr. M. Sambasiva Rao, President, Mr. A. Prabhakar Naidu, Chief Financial Officer, Mr. J. Sambamoorthy, Chief Operating Officer, Mr. Umakant Barik, Company Secretary and Compliance Officer, and Mr. Vinay Vattal, CEO, Heritage Nutrivet. Before we get started, I would like to remind you that the remarks today might include forward-looking statements, and actual results differ from those contemplated by forward-looking statements. Any statements we make on this call today is based on our assumptions as on date, and we have no obligations to update these statements as a result of new information or future events. I would now like to invite Dr. M. Sambasiva Rao from Heritage Foods to make his opening remarks. Thank you. Over.
Thank you, Hiral. A very good evening to all the participants today on this call. We are happy to welcome you all to this earnings call of Heritage Foods to discuss the financial and operating performance for the Q1 of FY22. I hope all of you are safe and healthy during this pandemic times. A detailed presentation has been uploaded on the exchanges and on our website. I do hope everyone had an opportunity to look at it. Now let me take you through the highlights on the financial and operational aspects of quarter one of FY22. Consolidated revenue for Q1 was at 6,481 million rupees as compared to 6,388 million in previous year's Q1. EBITDA was at 588 million as compared to 520 million in Q1 FY21. EBITDA margin stood at 8% now as against 8.7% in the previous year same quarter. Adjusted PAT grew by 3.7% year-on-year to 303 million. Overall, the profitability of dairy has improved during Q1. That is, if you take standalone performance, net turnover was 638 crores versus 606 crores, registering 5% growth. EBITDA of standalone is 53 crores versus 46 crores, registered 15.6% growth. PBT of standalone is 40.41 versus 33 of last year. Now I take up Heritage Nutrivet, our wholly owned subsidiary. Sales stood at 241 million in Q1 as against 345 million in the last year Q1. EBITDA stood at 23 million as against 52 million in the last year. PBT stood at 14.9 million versus 42.7 million. On the balance sheet front, the long-term debt stood at 36.4 crores, that is 364 million at consolidated level as on 30th June 2021. The company has a strong balance sheet with debt equity ratio at 0.04:1 and cash and bank balance of 700 million as on 30th June 2021. Moving on to the volume performance, the average milk procurement during this quarter was at 1.2 million liters per day as compared to 1.4 million liters in the last year same quarter. Average milk sales, the liquid milk sales during current year's Q1 was at 0.95 million liters per day compared to 0.92 million liters during last year. While curd sales during quarter one was at 292 metric tons per day compared to 253 metric tons per day during the last year, registering 15% growth year on year. During this quarter, value-added products revenue surged by 11% year on year to 1,746 million rupees. The contribution of value-added product revenue also increased to 27.4% versus 25.3% during the last year same quarter. There are a few other developments which I would like to share with you all, which is already in the public domain. Our senior management team is now strengthened with onboarding of Mr. Srideep Nair Kesavan as the company's CEO. Prior to joining Heritage Foods, Mr. Kesavan held over two decades of leadership positions at Coca-Cola and Olam International as an innovative marketer and enterprising business leader with deep domain expertise across sales and distribution, marketing, category management, and P&L. The company continued with its efforts of enhancing value-added product portfolio, and I'm happy to inform you that the company during this Q1 forayed into new ready-to-eat segment, that is heat and eat tikka paneer. Additionally, we also launched spice butter and cup curd in Mumbai market during this quarter. Heritage Novandi is delighted to bring Mami Yoga branded deliciously French yogurt along with our unique offering, the Yo Pop, a drinkable yogurt in Hyderabad market through Heritage Foods distribution network. The company expects to grow its value-added product share in the coming years by consistently launching new healthy value-added products. The company's growth mantra is to empower farmers and build strong product portfolio through its consumer-centric approach. Heritage aspires to be a nationally recognized brand for healthy and fresh products with a focus on efficient capital management and maximizing shareholders' value. Now, the floor is open for question answers. If any of you have any queries or feedback, post this call, you may please connect to Dickenson World, our new investor relations agency. Thank you for the time and patience.
Thank you.
Now it's open for discussion.
Thank you, sir. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to withdraw yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sameer Gupta from IIFL. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening, sir, and thank you for taking my question. So first question is regarding this new development of Mr. Srideep joining. So any color you can give, sir, on the broad strategy of getting a new CEO on board, any revised targets for the company, what exactly is the thought process, broadening portfolio, going aggressive on marketing, changing or modifying organizational structure, revenue growth, anything related to broad strategy behind this appointment?
Yeah,
that's my first question. Yes, sir.
To take.
Yeah, this is Ramani here. Thank you for joining the call. So basically, the targets for the company remain more or less the same, that we want to grow at over 20% when it comes to revenue to be able to reach our target of increasing value-added products, from the current 29% contribution of revenue to 45 to 50%. Now, in order to be doing that, I think there are several things that we realize we need to be focusing on as an organization. One, importantly, being consumer-centric focus to bring about the transformation and to bring about high growth as we move from being just a dairy company to an FMCG sort of approach. So that's where we believe Mr. Shrivi's experience cross-functionally would be helpful, be it in the domain of marketing, where he has rich experience, and operations, and as a result of handling several other functions such as HR and being responsible for P&L, etc., he will bring in value. He's just joining the organization this month. I think we'll be able to co-create a more specific strategy post his formal joining within the organization and give you more light on the same during our next call.
Look forward to that, Brahmani. Thanks for this. Second question is more on the quarter. So last year we saw the lockdown affecting the Horeca channels and the milk procurement prices saw a dip. This quarter again the restrictions were imposed, but we don't see any gross margin advantage. So what differently happened this time?
Compared to the previous year's same quarter, this year procurement prices were higher than the last financial year. That's a major difference. And to some extent, the logistics costs also were higher with the increased fuel prices.
And so sequentially, there was a drop in milk procurement prices?
No, I am talking about comparative data of last year same quarter. Compared to last year same quarter, this year milk prices were higher. As you know, the markets were almost restored in the Q4 of last year. All markets were open and milk prices went up with the increased demand. That has not come down to as low as last financial year's quarter one this year. That is a significant difference from last year Q1 to this year Q1 in terms of farm gate prices.
Got it, sir. Sir, one request. You used to share the liquid milk prices and milk procurement prices every quarter. Just a request if you could, you know, give it for this quarter.
The last year quarter one to this year quarter one, there was an increase of 3% in terms of milk price per liter.
This is procurement?
Yeah, last year
procurement.
Average procurement price of effluent home milk, it was 34.49 rupees per liter, and this year same average price of cow and buffalo milk, it is 33.45 per liter. So there is an increase of 3%.
Got it, sir. Thank you. And the selling price, sir?
Selling prices remain more or less same, except for the variant mix and market mix. There was no price increase in terms of sale prices of milk last year quarter one to this year quarter one.
Got it, sir. Thank you. I'll come back in the queue for any follow-ups. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
The next question is from the line of Swecha Chen, ANS Wealth. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for giving this opportunity. So my first question is, it seems that more or less our cattle feed business has kind of attained scale. So if you could guide us as to, what kind of sustainable EBITDA margins, we can expect from this business, once we expand our footprints in all other locations.
Sure. I request Mr. Vinay, the CEO of HNL, Heritage NutriVet, to respond to you.
Good evening.
Yeah.
The margins are subdued in quarter one, yes, because the raw material prices have been, as you must be aware, the soya prices are competing with diesel prices now. And in fact, today they have overtaken diesel prices. So given that, the margins are subdued, but we expect that going forward, specifically as we approach H2, which is traditionally when the new crop arrives, the margins would come back to the expected and the last year levels.
Last year levels, right? Okay. And so my second question actually pertains to, a follow-up on the earlier participant question. So if you could quantify the current milk procurement price, what are they now in July and what were they in Q1 FY22? And also if you could, throw some light on the current skim milk prices, because I believe they have softened a bit. So, would it impact our margins?
We are constrained not to talk about current quarter prices. We will explain to you later.
Okay. So, but how about the skim milk prices? Do you think they would impact our margin?
Skim milk prices, we don't deal with normally skim milk for our day-to-day requirements. We buy the whole milk from the farmers.
Okay. Perfect, sir. So I have a few more questions. I'll rejoin the queue. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, if you have any questions, please enter star and one. The next question is from the line of Isha Sheet from Anvil Shares and Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Hello. Sir, wanted to ask the difference between milk procured and milk sell, the quantity, what is it used for, or it is the wastage?
Sorry, can you elaborate? I couldn't understand.
So we procure around 1.2 in this quarter, and we sold 0.95. So difference between procurement and sold milk, what is the difference? Why is the difference?
Okay. The difference is the rest of the milk is used for other products like curd, paneer, buttermilk, flavored milk, all other value-added products. The 9.5 million is a sale of liquid milk.
Liquid, okay.
The rest of the milk is used for other products. That's
okay.
Where the revenue of value-added products is getting reported.
Oh. Okay. And so I wanted to check, you mentioned that procurement price is 34.49 in this quarter, right?
Yes.
And selling price is similar to last quarter.
Correct.
And so I wanted to ask that last year, when we, just do the simple maths of selling price minus procurement price, then in FY21, it was 11 rupees per liter. But in FY18, it was 5 rupees per liter. So is there, we have some minimum profit in our mind to keep between procurement and selling price?
It's not that simple, straightforward difference to be arrived at. There is a mix of value-added products. There is a mix of milk powder, surplus fat generated and sold as butter and ghee. It's a function of multiple activities. I don't think we'll be able to explain as a straight line difference between buy price and sell price, because it's just not milk sold like that. There's a cream separated from the full cream milk and reduced and sold as double toned milk, toned milk. Multiple complexities are there. You need to perhaps understand the costing and selling prices separately. May not be feasible on this call.
Sure. Thank you. And sir, I wanted to check which is our focus area in value-added products. Which product is major contribution? Curd is major, but going forward, it would be?
Yeah. Curd continues to be the lead product, keeping the consumer habits in mind. It will be a kind of flagship lead product. The rest will follow, because curd has to share. No other product can beat that kind of numbers. That's essentially a function of consumer habit.
around 45% of our sales to value added products to the overall sales, and right now it is at 29%. So that requires a compounded growth of around 30-35% in value added products. Is it possible? I mean, what we need to increase the what are the strategies to achieve that 45-50% of sales? Because the growth rate would itself become 35%, growing value added products at 35%. If you can elaborate, please.
Yeah, Brahmani, would you like to respond?
Yeah, certainly, sir. Definitely, I think the growth rate will have to be higher in value-added products versus liquid milk itself, which is the trend we've been seeing in the past couple of years. And in fact, despite several headwinds in Q1, also we've seen that the growth rate of that was higher than that of milk. And now, given the current situation that things are getting better, economies are opening up, states are opening up, we believe that consumer demand should come back for value-added products, and we should grow in the positive direction. Added to that, I think more focus into marketing and bringing in this consumer-centric approach is something that will further reiterate and penetrate the brand in value-added products much better going forward.
Okay. And just the last question. Salaries of MD and executive director have increased. Is it in proportion to the profit? Because the increase is more than the other companies. So just wanted to, or is it only for this year?
Basically, the remuneration is structured in our company as a fixed pay and variable pay. There's a fixed pay approved for the period of 5 years by the board and AGM. That remains constant for 5 years without any annual increase. It's a fixed for 5 years. Every month, every year, the pay is same for 5 years. There's a second element of remuneration called variable pay based on the performance. There are basically performance factors is the profitability. When the profit is low, the variable pay take home will be low. When it is high, it will be higher. That is how it is structured to encourage or incentivize the high performing year.
Okay.
So move on with the performance. The significant part of the pay is a performance pay.
Okay. Thank you so much.
That's
it from my side.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Bhargav Buddhadev from Kotak Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, team, and thank you for the opportunity. We've seen about a double-digit decline in milk procurement in this particular quarter. So, anything to read through this? Because 17% decline, I think, has happened after many, many quarters.
Yes, Ms. Bhargav. Good evening, Mr. Murthy, our COO, will respond to this.
Sure.
Good evening. Actually, there is no drop in our own milk procurement. Last year, we purchased skim milk and converted into S&P. So that because of the skim milk prices were low, and convert bought it and converted into S&P. And that S&P, now we are using it in this year. So that is the difference. Otherwise, there is no decline.
So is there a lot of S&P inventory still lying with us?
So it is there is inventory available, but which is meant for internal consumption only, which will come another 3,500 tons SMB is available, and which is meant for internal consumption only in the coming month.
Secondly, sir, when we are looking at significant growth in our value-added product portfolio, Ma'am mentioned close to about 50% of revenue. Are we looking at upgrading our advertising and marketing budget? Because without that, it's difficult to sort of achieve such higher targets. So with the new team coming in place, like we hired a professional CEO for Nutrivet and now for foods as well, is there a sort of a DNA change where we'll be aggressive in terms of marketing spend also and sort of look at achieving the 50% maybe in the next 3 years' time, the share of value added?
Yes, Yes, we are going to increase our spends in future as we are going to focus more on value-added products, and this spends also mainly through this online marketing activity, social and digital media, and also on-ground visibility activity.
Any budgets which you can share, what percentage of revenue will be spent on advertising?
So currently, what our spends were actually like, if you take last few years, it was at about 0.5% and 0.3% and 0.24% previous years. Then it is going to be actually more in this financial year.
Okay, so will we be doubling it or more than that?
Yeah, based on the need actually, yeah, it will be going to be more.
Okay, thank you very much and all the very best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitesh Jain from Birla Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening everyone. So my question is on Ms. Brahmi's, answer to one of the earlier participants' question regarding the 20% type of revenue growth and more consumer-centric approach in a, you know, FMCG type of company. Question here is, to achieve that and such a decent revenue growth target, what approach are you going to follow this time? Because in the past, you have done some sort of some acquisitions which were not successful. So is it going to be organic this time? This is one question. And number two, instead of doing acquisition and chasing just the revenue, will the company be investing more in a heritage brand and using the same distribution, network, which is quite strong in my view? How do you think that, for next 5 years? This is the question.
Yeah, so this is Kamli here again. Of course, this is a strategy which is ongoing, but to your question on acquisition, I think that's something we look at opportunistically. As we speak today, there is no strong, compelling candidate that we're looking at right now, especially because we're so focused on the quality of our raw material and we want to have control over it, which is something that's helped us as a brand significantly. On the next question on distribution. Yes, the dynamic of distribution today is quite strong for us. And in fact, what's made us grow to the level we are today over the last close to three decades is the strength of our distribution network. So that will continue for a certain set of products, especially fresh products. But as we look at existing sort of ambient products, longer shelf life products, and any other future products, it will sort of have to be a combination of what we have today and an FMCG type of distribution network, including focusing more on modern retail format stores as well as e-com. We've seen a growth in e-com sales within our company itself, as mentioned during our last con call. So distribution channels and distribution mix will have to change.
Sure, fantastic. And my second question is on the this JV with Novandi for yogurt business. Not a particular year, but what is the potential revenue possible from this JV, say in 3 years' time? Any estimate, any internal numbers you are working with?
I think I will come back with more clarity going forward. Product has just been launched in the market. We launched the product on, to be more specific, on the 16th of February in the Maharashtra market. Quite recently, we launched the product also in the Hyderabad market, and the feedback and the response to the product is very encouraging for us.
Okay.
Secondly, we have a partner, which is a private company. So, I can't share too much information at this point in time.
Sure.
But offline, I can share more information about the same. But to just give an example, I think among the Western products which are generally doing well in the Indian market, yogurt is one space which is very attractive, and it is a logical sort of extension to curd or dahi in the Indian market. So we're really excited about the growth potential this has.
Fantastic. And lastly, to achieve this 45-50% value-added proportion, in line with the recent launches, be it yogurt or the ready-to-eat paneer, can we expect more such launches in, say, coming months? For the new products.
Several different products. Yeah, several different products in the past 1 year. And since we've launched our line of cheeses, be it slices, cubes, blocks, spreads, mozzarella. We've also launched probiotic curd. We launched immunity milks. We've launched cold coffee, which is, taken off quite interestingly. And we also very recently introduced tikka paneer, which is a ready-to-eat, ready-to-cook sort of product, thinking about convenience because we believe in the future of paneer. Similarly, in the current quarter, we will be launching Shrikhand and Amarkand in relevant markets, Maharashtra, etc. Going forward, yes, there are products in the pipeline. However, we believe our plate is quite full, and penetration within existing products itself is a huge opportunity for us. So we don't want to, spread ourselves too thin either. So again, taking the consumer-centric marketing approach forward, we will penetrate more in existing products, be it curd, where we're already a leader, be it paneer, be it undrinkables, be it ice creams, etc.
Wonderful. All right. Thank you very much. That's all. Really appreciate your response.
Thank you. Since if you have any questions, please enter star and one. The next question is from the line of Sivakumar K. from Unify Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Sir, I had one question on the increase in revenue that you're targeting around 20%. So what will be the key geographies that you'll be targeting when you want to grow the revenue at 20%? Is there more scope to grow in our current core market, or do you need to expand into new regions?
We'll be operating in the same markets. For example, if you take AP, Telangana, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, these are the markets where we go down into tier 2, tier 3 suburbs, etc. When we go to recently entered markets like Delhi or Mumbai, we'll be focusing on the urban areas, those two states, those two markets. Beyond this, we are not looking at any new territories as such.
Right, sir. Sir, and I just wanted to pick your brain on the milk cycle per se, because currently sitting in Q1, how do you see the milk prices behaving in the flush season, which is closer to Q3? Because in FY19, we have seen the prices being at a very low level because there was plenty of milk. And then in FY20, we saw very high prices because of scarcity situation. How do you see FY21 panning out during the peak season?
Shivkumar, this is a very peculiar scenario of dairy. We used to have two cycles in the earlier years, October to March, called flush season, where production of milk is very high. Prices are the lowest in December, January period. And the second season, April to September, called lean season, where the prices, milk production will be lower, prices will be highest during July, August kind of months. That used to be a very standard kind of production cycle connected to price trend. But of late, let's say a 10-year cycle if you take, there were certain years where this rhythm is not regular. It's getting irregular, uncertain, unpredictable. And it was more so after 2015. There was no such flush, there was no such lease. Some year, full year was on lean only. There was no price drop. So it has become very unpredictable, erratic, attributed to multiple factors. Mainly climate change, the rainfall and drought, floods have disturbed the cycle. Secondly, global price trends and global economies. 1 year, the Chinese economy went into recession. They didn't buy much of the stocks in the global market. 1 year, there was a tension between Europe and Russia. There was a diplomatic tension and there was embargo on the trade between Europe and Russia. So the stocks moved from different continents. And 1 year there was a problem in New Zealand with drought. There was a production fall and it impacted. So global factors, diplomatic relations, the climate changes, coupled with certain export-import policy decisions of our central government and the incentives related to state governments, they are all not letting the cycle to be on its natural course of flush, lean, high price summer, low price winter. The cycle got disturbed, and this got further aggravated with the pandemic last year. So once the national lockdown was imposed, there was so much a fall in the demand, out of home consumption collapsed, markets got closed. So the milk supply continued from the farmers. Every company has picked up milk to protect the livelihoods of farmers and the relationship with farmers. And we also picked up and converted into powder and butter sold or consuming internally. So the prices have fallen in the first quarter, and slowly it picked up by end of the financial year in Q4. Again, the wave two hit in March, end of March and April, May. The prices have gone down, but not as low as last year. And now we are going through a lean season. The lowest production happens in August in the year normally, and in buffalo milk area. Now we are going through that lower production and higher prices. And if everything goes well and there is no wave three hitting India, the prices may again get impacted one way. If wave three comes and again markets get impacted, they fluctuate. So we are going through a very challenging and difficult phase in the dairy system. No one can tell you what exactly is going to happen in the next 6 months. One, from the cycle of the pandemic, the vaccination and its impact, or wave three and its impact. Other, from the climate, where it is raining, when it is raining, why it is raining, and what its impact on the dairy. And the lockdowns and the regulations also impacted artificial insemination cycle. Normally, artificial insemination happens during certain months, leading to conceiving and the deliveries, lactation and milk availability. The veterinarians were unable to travel through the villages during this last 1.5 years. Everyone has their own issues of public health, personal health, and difficulties. So the artificial insemination also didn't happen as expected. So that will also impact on the rate of deliveries and lactation. So it's very difficult to predict and clearly say, but if the natural trend comes, come October, production should improve, prices should soften.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a detailed perspective. I know it's how challenging it is.
Before you ask the question, so bear with me.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Appreciate the detailed answer. So just one last question. Qualitatively, of course, you can't give the numbers, but qualitatively, from July, can we say that the core South Indian markets where you are operating are now closer to normalcy? When I say normalcy, the HoReCa segment should also be doing much better than what we saw last year, right?
Yes. Markets are open and demand is rising.
Great, sir. Great to hear.
One more factor just to keep in mind is the work from home option given to large number of IT companies and schools being closed. Those who have migrated out of urban areas to their native places are yet to come back. Though the offices are open, they are still operating on the work from home front. And only the opening of schools will bring the parents back to urban areas. We operate mostly in urban areas. Our consumption is in urban areas. So the full-fledged recovery in the demand will happen once all the workforce returns to urban areas.
Got it, sir. Thank you, sir. That's it from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anirudh Joshi from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
So thanks for the opportunity. So can you indicate the procurement price again in Q1 FY21 and Q1 FY22?
34.49. Yes, last year 33.45 per liter of average of cow and buffalo.
Okay, 33.45 last year same quarter. Okay, understood. Sir, also lastly, if you can indicate curd sales in rupees terms, means rupees lakhs or rupees million.
Sorry, Anirudh, could you repeat?
Sir, curd sales in rupees million or rupees lakhs means basically rupee terms, not the quantity.
Revenue from curd sales.
Revenue from curd sales, correct.
Just a moment. Anirudh, we give current year first quarter.
Sure, sir.
₹141 crores is the current year quarter one curd revenue.
141 crores. This is June 2021 quarter revenues. Sign if possible June 2020 quarter as well.
Yeah, that's not there. Just a moment.
Sure.
It was 126 crores last year.
126 crores. Okay. With now induction of multiple professionals in NutriVet business as well as the dairy business also. So just a question for Brahmani madam. So how do you see the family's participation in actual management role? So we have seen in many consumer companies like Asian Paints or even Berger or other like Dabur, etc. So over a period of time, the family has taken a kind of backseat in actual management of the business, and professionals have taken over completely the day-to-day running or even the strategic decisions of the business also. So do we see such similar trend in case of Heritage too? So do you see over a period of next 5 odd years entirely the business run by professionals, or family continue to have a majority say in the management?
Anirudh, she just joined the business. You are asking her to retire?
No, sir. What will be the role then? That is the only question.
We all do this business well. I don't expect retirement so early.
No, sir, not at all about retirement. I'm sorry if I have asked the question wrongly. Really sorry, but means what will be the role? That's the only question. Yeah.
You take my answer rightly.
Okay. Sure, sir. Sorry. Okay.
Thank you, Anand.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rohit from Samatva Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi. Good evening. I just had a couple of questions. My first question was on the additional curd capacity that's coming up in the next few quarters. So, what the capacity comes in, and what will be the peak revenues you can achieve from those curd capacity? That's my first question. In the next 2 to 3 years.
Yeah. So we've coming here. We've added in the past 1 year. We've added about 125 tons in curd capacity to our existing capacity. In 50 tons in Telangana, 50 in AP, and another 25 in Maharashtra. This year we don't intend to increase the capacity because this will suffice for the next financial year. So that's where we are at when it comes to curd capacities.
Okay. And my second question was just a small data point. What will be the mix between cow milk and buffalo milk? Some broad number.
Yeah, it keeps fluctuating again because cow milk production cycle, buffalo milk production cycles are different in terms of lactation start time, end time. We average out to 60-40, 60 cow and 40% buffalo at an annual level, but month level, quarter level, it keeps fluctuating depending on the seasonality.
So, Ryan, 2 years back, was that a similar range or was it like pre-COVID? That's my basic question.
It was a little more on buffalo side. It would have been, let's say, 43-44% buffalo and 56-57 cow. During this period, the buffalo milk has come down a bit.
Okay. Great, sir. Thank you so much and wishing you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dipen Sheth from Crystal Investment Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Please proceed.
Okay. Thanks for the opportunity. My question is perhaps driven by my inadequate understanding of the company. So please forgive me. This sounds a little redundant. But I'm just looking at your stated chilling capacity, which is at 21 lakh liters per day. And you have procured about 12 lakh liters per day in the last quarter. And I think the peak that you would have done has also been about 14, 15 lakh, but I'm not sure, right? So the question is, we have a very large, much larger chilling capacity to chill primary milk, which is procured. And we are just about maybe, 60 or 70% of the way there. Is the constraint in our ability to distribute and sell, or is the constraint in our ability to procure?
Yeah, there are multiple ways this could be understood. One, in terms of chilling capacity, 21 lakhs, and procurement 12 or 14. In the peak season, peak months, we might be procuring 15, 16 lakhs. And the lean season, it will go to 11 lakhs, 10 lakhs. Right. So averages keep changing, one, year average. Second is, it's a legacy issue. Our company started 29 years ago. At that time, there were very few players in a particular locality. A company has built 50,000 liters chilling center per day capacity in a particular location, anticipating that kind of milk, and that kind of milk has come 20 years back, 25 years back. Over a period of three decades, the number of players have come and set up their facilities around that location, in the same location. Several people have come. The milk shed or milk pool remained same, or there is a marginal increase. The sharing of the milk shed's milk reduced the ability for chilling centers to procure 50,000. So over a period of time, what happened? We have to set up smaller units of 5,000, 10,000 liter capacities deeper in the milk collection areas. So there used to be one chilling center at let us say taluk level, tahsil level, block level. These are the administrative units in the government. Yeah. And now we have gone below the block levels and set up the smaller units. So the larger units have become redundant over a period of time. So therefore the capacity remains underutilized in those locations as the milk got shared, same milk pool divided by more people. And we started expanding into the deeper areas to pull up the milk from the distant places. So that's how certain capacities are underutilized. That is one way. Second is the procurement volumes and sale volumes typically go hand in hand. Whatever is the market demand, we try to catch up buying up back-end infrastructure. Certain markets, we may be going faster. Like for example, X market, we were doing 50,000 liters and now it has gone to 1 lakh liters. In that area, there will be a procurement shortage. That area's potential is low. Milk availability is low in a particular territory, but demand is high. Take a case of Hyderabad. Hyderabad demand is far, far superior to milk availability in 300 kilometers around Hyderabad.
Right.
Similarly, if you take Chennai, the milk availability is far, Bangalore, milk availability is far higher than milk requirement in Bangalore. So these mismatches are there. So certain areas we need to add capacity, though in some other area capacity is underutilized. In Karnataka, my capacity is underutilized. I cannot stop growing in Telangana. are milk required for Hyderabad. So the growth and growth of demand and supply areas imbalance is there. That is how this looks higher. It doesn't answer directly why the differences are there. So you have to really understand the milk production areas, milk consumption areas, logistics cost involved, perishability of the product.
Right.
We have another commitment to offer fresh milk to consumers. We do not carry Pune milk to Delhi or Tirupati milk to Delhi. We try to procure milk in within the nearby areas, and fresh milk we want to deliver next day to the farmer, unlike certain brands who will have milk transit distance itself 3 days, 4 days.
I appreciate that. Does it mean that there is
create limited capacity, but transport long distance over 2-3 days and give stale milk to consumers, which is against our principle of quality standards.
Okay. Okay, sir. And the milk powder that we are carrying in the inventory, how do we value this? Since it's probably a substantial part of inventory as we speak.
We have conservative accounting, cost of production versus current market prices. Comparing both, the lowest of the two we take.
I think that's a very good answer. But the first answer was pretty detailed and much more than what I would have bargained for. Thanks very much, sir.
Thank you.
Participants, if you have any questions, please enter star and one. The next question is from the line of Deepak Madhavdas from LSA Securities. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir, good evening to all, sir. Sir, ma'am was speaking about, you know, shifting, we are shifting more towards the FMCG business. What is the bouquet we would like we would see in the future? Huh? So one product what we launch is this ready-to-eat tikka. And what are the similar products which we can see in that?
Yeah, this is Ramani here again. We have several products that already appeal to the FMCG space. All our products are fast moving. All our products are consumer good products. So, you know, be it our existing value-added product, curd, or existing fun bridges, drinkables, all of them, fat products, ghee, butter, all of them appeal to FMCG.
I just wanted to know, since we have launched this product, paneer tikka, what are the similar products are we going to launch, and which are the main targets for us? Will it be the hospitality sector directly, or it will be directly we hit the consumers?
Oh, no. We've been very clear since the beginning that we are a purely B2C company. We will not focus on other channels significantly. We will only go to consumers, and that's why we're so focused on building a stronger image and a stronger brand towards the consumer. We believe that that will give us strength and sustainable growth in top line and bottom line.
Yeah, madam, do we see any similar products in the same line, madam? In ready-to-eat category?
We have some products in the pipeline. It's too early to discuss that now. But
madam,
as mentioned earlier, this quarter we will be launching Amarkand and Shrikhand.
Okay, got it. And madam, in this Novandi tie-up, can we see more of products in that side also?
We currently have 8 SKUs, 4 in the stirred fruit yogurt space, 4 in the drinkable yogurt space. We will focus on growing these products. However, seasonally, some flavors might be changing. But the idea is to first focus on stirred and drinkable product yogurts as product categories and grow them in our markets, namely Maharashtra and now Telangana as well.
Okay, madam, got it. How much is the revenue we are looking for this, madam, ready to eat and this in the current year and in the next year, right?
Yeah, so as mentioned, they're all part of our value-added products. So they are part of our plan to reach the 45% contribution of our revenues. In terms of specific numbers, I will request Mr. Murthy to talk about plans of tikka paneer.
Yeah.
We are actually expecting that about 25 tons to 30 tons per month, volume quantity.
And sir, your voice is echoing, sir. Can you please repeat?
Yeah. Hello. We are expecting at about 25 tons to 30 tons per month.
And what would be the value for that, sir, in rupee terms or revenue terms? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Around 1 crore.
Okay, that would be a very small portion. Okay, sir. Okay, got it, sir. That's from my side, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Due to time constraint, I would now like to hand the conference over to Dr. M. Sembasiva Rao for closing comments.
Thank you very much, all the participants, for interaction with us and continued interest in Heritage Foods. And we will be coming back to you with greater details in the coming call. Thank you very much, and stay safe and take care.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Heritage Foods Limited, that concludes the conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.